Blackstone Audio presents Buster, the Military Dog Who Saved 1,000 Lives by RAF Police Flight Sergeant Will Barrow, as told to Isabel George. This book is read by James Langton. To Izzy for her hard work, Tracy and my family for their unwavering support, and all military working dog handlers and their fantastic dogs, especially those who have made the ultimate sacrifice for Queen and country. Prologue.
Buster, where the bloody hell are you?
I had no idea why I said that. I knew that Buster would be no more than a whisker's width away from me. I heard him sigh, as if to say, "For goodness sake, mate, just calm down. We're out for a ride, that's all." But that's Buster's view of the world. Even in this inky blackness, as we sat in the belly of a Viking armored vehicle, he would be thinking he was just out on a trip with his friends, and, if he was lucky, one or two of them might have a bit of food to share. After all, this dog was already a veteran of 2 tours of Bosnia. If the journey ended with a long walk, then this boring sitting still bit would have all been worth it. It was early in our relationship, and I realized how jealous I was becoming of Buster's simple logic. That morning, we were up at 0300. An hour and 15 minutes later, we were kitted and booted and routed to the spot by the sound of something very solid heading our way. The earth shook under our feet, and while Buster sat in a Sunday morning kind of pose, wondering if the early start meant a second breakfast, I studied the dark horizon for clues. Suddenly, the entire perimeter of forward operating base, FOB, Price was blindingly illuminated, and for a few seconds Buster and I stood like a pair of startled rabbits. We were witnessing the arrival of the Viking troop of the Royal Marines. The convoy had driven for 2 hours overnight from Camp Bastion. Relying entirely on their night vision goggles to cover the distance, the drivers brought the vehicles through the darkness to the base's main gates before switching to full beam. Winding down to the harbour, the Vikings came to an ear-splitting halt with the screech of their metal tracks. Vikings are huge, ugly, tracked, armoured vehicles. They come in 2 parts. The front has a can for the driver, commander, and gunner. The gunner is stood with his head out of a hatch in the top and armed with a general-purpose machine gun, GPMG or Gimpy, or a .50 caliber heavy machine gun, HMG, both of which will ruin your day. Behind this is a powerful engine that propels it along at speed. The rear compartment is for troops or supplies. It will seat 6 people, but any more than 4 is pretty uncomfortable. As usual, everything is covered in sand and dust, which has to be constantly cleaned out. At this time, the Vikings were feared by the Taliban, and this morning's had come to collect me and Buster and deliver us to our unit in the field. True to form, Buster sprang into action, meeting and greeting the guys who clearly looked a lot less boring than me. Panting and wagging his stumpy tail, he leapt into the Viking, ready for another mini-adventure packed with fresh smells, noises, and voices. Despite the gloominess inside, I knew Buster could see me, but his focus would be on getting a seat. As the engine rumbled away, I quickly dealt with the practical side of things, such as storing our bags. My bulging Bergen was full of Buster's food, but the Marine Sergeant lifted it onto his shoulder as if it was a child's lunchbox. Tearing open the rear armor-plated door, he dropped my stuff into the main compartment. I crouched down before stepping in to join the heaving, breathing bodies of 2 hefty Royal Marines in full body armor. I was given a headset so I could hear all communications between the commander, driver, and gunner above the noise of the engine in the front can. Buster was already in there somewhere, but I couldn't see him on any of the seats. After a little jostling with bags, rifles, and body mass, I sat and shuffled my feet to create some personal space and some Buster space. No one knew how long the journey to the patrol area was going to take. Christ, it was getting hot, and I knew Buster must be feeling the heat too. "It's okay, pal, don't worry," I said, hoping my voice was steady. But I think I needed the reassurance more than he did. After a short while, we joined Highway 1, A decent, proper road by local standards, which encircles Afghanistan. Suddenly I realized that this was it. I couldn't escape now, even if I wanted to. And I admit that there were times as I packed, unpacked, and repacked my kit for the umpteenth time that I had thought of taking an immediate career break.
Okay, where are you, Buster?
I pushed my right foot in front of me. It connected with something soft but solid. Buster. Buster didn't like sitting on the floor. In fact, Buster...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.